Hello, let's begin our class. And yesterday I updated the quiz results, and you can take a look. And one student, he answered in paper sheets, but he did not write down his student ID and his name, so I didn't know how to register his scores. So if you take the quiz, but your quiz score is not on the list, please contact me. And I also updated the results of assignment 2. You can take a look. I also provided some examples of incorrect outputs. You need to take a look if you get a zero accuracy. And your program outputs must match the input output samples exactly. Exactly means every character of your output must be the same as the one in the input output samples. And to do this, you can use the mouse to select the output of your program, and copy the selection to some text editor. And also you paste the assignment sample to the text editor and compare the two. Then you can find whether your program outputs are the same as input output samples. And the next week is the midterm exam. And the location is this classroom. And this is a paper and pencil exam, so you cannot use mobile phones or bring your textbook, or you cannot use calculators. And this week, I will finish the function basics, and I will also finish the arrays chapter. And let's go to the function basics. And in the previous week, we learned how to define our own functions. So here is one example. We can define our own function. For example, the total cost. And you can do some experiments. Here is the function definition. Total cost is the function name, and after the function name is a parenthesis. And inside the parenthesis are the function inputs. And you can determine how many inputs you want. And you need to specify the data type and the variable name. So in this definition, we have two inputs. The first input is an integer, and the second input is a double. And you also need to determine the return data type. This function will return a double variable. So you need to write the return data type. you don't need to you don't need to write a variable name. You only need to write a return data type. So here, the return data type corresponding to the return statement. So if here you use double, then you need to return a double variable. And if you don't want to return any variable, you can declare a void function. And if you use if the return data type is void, then you don't need to return any variable. Now we can use this function. So to use this function, you can copy the first line. So then we need to supply two inputs. So you need to declare variables. Then you can use this function call, and this function returns a double variable. So you can assign the return value to some double variable, and you can print the value of this variable. And we know that the function call must match the definition. So if this function is a void function, suppose this function is a void function, then you cannot assign its return value because this function returns nothing. So if this function is a void function, then you don't have a return value for this function call. So here the function call must match the definition of the function definition. And in this example, I only define a function. I do not declare a function. So in this example, I do not declare a function. This is because if you put the function definition before the main function, then you don't need to declare this function. But if you put the function definition after the main function, in this case, you need to declare this function. Now I put the function definition after the main function. And if you compile this program, you will see total cost, the function. This is a function call, and this function was not declared in this scope. So if you put the function definition after the main function, then you need to declare this function. And to declare this function, you just copy the first line of the function definition and add a semicolon to end this statement. So this line is known as function declaration. The purpose of the function declaration is to tell compiler how to interpret the function call. For example, the compiler sees this function call, and the compiler need to find the corresponding function declaration or the corresponding function definition. The function call must match function definition and match the function declaration. Usually, the declaration is above the main function. And to declare a function, you can omit the variable name. You can use this line to declare a function. So you can omit the variable name when you declare a function. But we suggest you use the first line, the first wave, to keep the function the variable name, because the variable name can tells you the purpose of each input. So it is better to choose the first style. And this is the function definition. You cannot put the function definition inside the main function. You can put the function definition after or before the main function, but you cannot put the function definition inside the main function. And this is the function call. This is the function call. And because this function returns a double variable, this function returns a double variable. So you can assign the return value to some variable. And for this function call, has two arguments. Arguments means inputs. This function has two inputs: number and the price. And the arguments can be variables or constants or expressions. So here you can use constants. Or you can use expressions. Expressions means a sequence of operations. And sometimes argument is also called parameter. So you can use the two terms interchangeably. And a function can call other function inside its definition. So when you define this function, you can make a function call inside this function. For example, you can call the square root function. Or you can also make a function call to yourself. So you can even make a function call to this function. So if a function call itself, and this is known as recursion. This is called a recursive function. I will not spend time on the introduction of the recursive function. Next, let's see another function. Now suppose we have the if statement like this. Inside the parentheses is a Boolean expression. So this Boolean expression is a bit complex. First, we use the AND logical operator to connect to comparison operators, and then we use the OR logical operator to connect the two Boolean expressions. And if you need to repeatedly evaluate this Boolean expression, then you can consider to write a function like this. So if you need to repeatedly to evaluate this Boolean expression, then you can write a function. The benefit of a function is that you can reuse this function many times. So for this example, now suppose rate is 15, and because rate satisfies this Boolean expression, so the result of this Boolean expression is true. So the if statement will be executed. Now we can write a function to replace this Boolean expression. So we can copy this Boolean expression. So we define a function. Suppose this function, you can choose any function name. And the input is rate. So for this function, we have one input, and the data type is integer. And then you need to determine the return data type. the return variable is a Boolean variable. So here, the return data type is the data type is bool. Because the return value is a Boolean value. And then we can use this function. And you can reuse this function many times. For example, so the second function call, its input is 21, and if you give a rate as 21, then you will find the Boolean expression. The Boolean expression becomes false. So this function returns false. And if this function returns false, then the else statement will be executed. So the console prints rate is invalid. And here introduce the void function. Void function means this function does not return any variable. So if this function does not return any variable, then the return data type is void. And the purpose of this function is to print some variables. The Fahrenheit degrees and here the first three lines is to set the precision of the double variables. Precision means you want to print how many digits after the principal after the decimal point. Although void function does not return any value, but you can still use the return statement inside a void function. Here is one example. The name of this function is ice cream division, and this function has two inputs. And if the first input is zero, then this function immediately returns. And we know that this function does not return anything. This function calls executes the return statement, but this statement does not return any variable because this is a void function. So for a void function, we can use the return statement, but this return statement does not return any variable. The purpose of this statement is to terminate the execution of this function. So if return is executed, then the following statement will be skipped. The textbook introduced preconditions and the postconditions. Precondition is comments, is the comments to to describe the function inputs. So for this function precondition describes the properties of the inputs. So this precondition describes balance and the rate. And my suggestion is that you don't need to write comments. You don't need to write comments like this. You can choose meaningful variable names or function names instead of writing preconditions. For example, if this variable is non-negative, you can change the variable name to non-negative balance. And if the rate is the interest rate, you can change the variable name to be interest rate. So so prefer to choose meaningful variable names and the function names instead of writing comments. And we also know that the main is also a function. So we see that when you write a C++ function, you need to write some code like this. And we know that main is a function. Every C++ program has a main function, and this function has no inputs, so inside the parentheses is empty because this function has no inputs, and the main function returns an integer value, so the return data type is integer, and corresponding to the return data type, you need to have a return statement for the main function. So if the main function is successfully executed, then the final statement is return 0, and the 0 is an integer corresponding to the return data type. When we execute the compile program, then the operating system will call the main function, and if the main function terminates, then the main function will return 0, will return this value. This slide talks about procedure abstraction, and the function definition is like a black box. So to use a function, you only need to know how to use it, but you don't need to understand its implementation. So the implementation of a function is like a black box. So for example, to use the square root function, So you don't need to understand the implementation of the square root function. You only need to know how to use it. So the function definition of a function is like a black box. And the next, we will go to the third part. The third part is about scope rules. Scope means the area you can access a variable. So let's see the local variable. So when this is one example. For this example, we define a function. And inside a function, you declare some variable. For example, average p. And this variable is called a local variable. And we can only access this variable within the function definition. You cannot access this variable outside the function definition. So this variable is local to this function definition. And the scope of this variable is the function definition. We can do some experiments. For here, I declare some function. Here I declare I define a function, and then I can make some function call. So the this function returns 10 because this function returns var2 plus var1. And the var2 is a local variable to this function definition. This means we cannot access var2 outside this function. So you cannot access var2 in the main function. And this will produce syntax error. Because var2 is declared inside the function definition. So var2 is local to this function definition. So the scope of var2 is within the function definition. So we cannot access var2 outside the function definition. So here we see the error message is var2 was not declared in this scope. But you can declare a variable var2 inside the main function. you can declare a variable. The variable name can be the same as the one inside the function definition. The two variables are independent because the two variables belong to different scopes. The first VAR2 belongs to the test function, while the second VAR2 belongs to the main function. So the two variable names are the same, but their scopes are different. The two variables are independent. So for the second VAR2, the second VAR2 is local to the main function. And we can also declare global variables. Global variables means every function can access this variable. And to declare global variables, we need to declare this. We can declare a variable outside the main function. For example, here I declare a variable outside the main function, and this function and this variable is known as a global variable. And every function has access to this variable. For example, I can use pi within the test function. So here, because pi is a global variable, so I can access this variable within the main function. And I can also access the pi variable inside the test function. However, use global variables are dangerous. Because every function can modify this value. For example, now suppose I want to compute the area of a circle. Now suppose I want to compute the area of some circle, and the area is 314. Now suppose, we can access the value or change the value of a global variable. So here we see some weird result. We make a function call to test, and you compute the area of a circle. But you find the area of a circle is -100. This is weird because pi should be 3.14, but now the value of pi becomes -1. This is because we modify the value inside the test function. Because pi is a global variable, and you can modify the value of a global variable within any function. So the suggestion is that do not use global variables, because you have no control over which function will modify this variable. But we suggest you to use global constants. Constants means its value cannot be changed. So we encourage you to use global constants. So you can use global constants like this. You can add a const keyword, and then this variable becomes read only. So for this one, if you add the const keyword, then this becomes a global constant. Then you cannot modify the value of a constant. So inside the test function, we cannot modify a read-only variable. So the use of global constants are encouraged. Next, let's see another related issues. When we write a for loop, we usually have a pair of braces. Or when you write if statement, you also will have a pair of braces. And this is known as a block. And you can put many statements inside this block. And all function definitions are blocks. And when you declare a function inside this, when you declare a variable inside this block, then the variable is local to this block. This means you can only access the variable within this block. For example, in this example, I declare a variable inside the for loop. So I can only access this variable within this block. I cannot access the value of I outside this block. So if you do this, this will lead to a syntax error. So this leads to a syntax error because I is declared inside the for loop, and outside the for loop you cannot access this variable. So the error message is I was not declared in this scope. And if you comment out this line, the syntax becomes legal. In this style is another example about scopes. We can use a pair of braces to compare to construct a scope. For this example, we inside the outer scope, we declare a variable x. Its initial value is 1, and then we created a inner block. And inside this inner block, we declare another variable x, and its value is 2. So we have two variables of the same variable name. The variable name are the same, are x, but the two variables, but the scopes of the two variables are different. The scope of the inner of the outer x belongs to the outer block. So the scope of the first x belongs to the outer block, while the scope of the second x belongs to the inner block. Now for this example, after the inner block, then we try to print the value of x. And do you know what is the value of x? The value is 1 or 2. If you think the value is 1, please raise your hand. If you think the value is 1, here, this line. If you think this line will print 1, then please raise your hand. And if you think the value of x is 2, when you print this line, please raise your hand. Oh, okay. You can do some experiments. When you execute this line, value of x will be 1. Because in this line, the inner block is finished, so we cannot access the x inside the inner block. So here x corresponds to the x in the outside block. So the value of x in this line should be 1. And you can do some experiments. So in the first x prints 1, the second x second CL prints 1, the third CL prints 2, and the final CL prints 1. And here, because the inner block is finished, so here after this block, when we refer to x, and this x corresponds to the x in the outer block. So here, the value of x is 1. I think the time is up, and we can have a break for 10 minutes.